सर एक न्यूमेरिकल किया था
हाँ जी, मुझे समझ लगी है, ये 2.1 वाला किया था हमने, ठीक है
इस...
हाँ जी 2.1 हमने कंप्लीट कर लिया था।
सर रिमूव कर दिया था, सेटिंग कर दें जरा प्लीज।
हाँ जी
सर रिमूव कर दिया था किसी ने इधर से, तो सेटिंग कर दें इसकी।
मुझे आपकी आवाज क्लियर नहीं आ रही दोबारा
सर। सर काइंडली सेटिंग कर दें,
बच्चे रिमूव कर रहे हैं एक दूसरे।
अच्छा कोई बात नहीं, अगर कोई रिमूव कर भी, मैंने उसको सेटिंग की है, अदरवाइज जो है क्या नाम है उसका लॉग फाइल पीछे बन रही होती है मेरे पास, वो मिल जाएगी। अच्छा अब मैं नहीं रिमूव कर सकते, मैंने सेटिंग एडजस्ट कर ली, ठीक है। अच्छा दोबारा फिर स्टूडेंट खुद ही वो ऐड हो सकते हैं टीम में?
सर नॉर्मली तो हो जाते हैं, मतलब
कोई नहीं, मेरे पास पीछे लॉग फाइल जनरेट हो जाती है, वो मैं नहीं
ओके सर
वो आ सकता हूँ एमएस टीम से, तो जो रिमूव कर रहा है वो रिकॉर्ड हो जाएगा मेरे पास, उसका कोई इशू नहीं था ना। ओके शुड आई स्टार्ट ए लेक्चर? ओके मैं लेक्चर स्टार्ट करता हूँ, एंड बिफोर स्टार्टिंग आई विल स्टार्ट ए रिकॉर्डिंग। बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। लास्ट टाइम वी हैव लर्न दैट हाउ टू कंप्यूट ग्रॉस एरिया एंड नेट एरिया फॉर एनी स्टील स्ट्रक्चरल मेंबर व्हिच इज कनेक्टेड बाय रिवेट और बोल्ट। Today we will discuss some more terminologies related with hole distance. So first of all, for example, you can see this steel plate which is subjected to tensile force along the length of the member. So when a force is acting along the longitudinal axis, it means that due to the tensile stresses, the plate or the section will or the element always break in transversal direction like in this way. So here we have to discuss different terminologies related with the hole distances. So first of all, we are having pitch. So here on this diagram, you can see that we are having five bolts or five holes punched in this plate. Bolts are provided or the holes, they are punched in two lines. So there are two lines along the length of member, and also in each line the bolts their centroidal axis they are not meeting. So here you can see that in one line we are having three bolts and in second line we are having two bolts. So let's suppose if a section will break, so it means that we have to consider the cross section which is in the transversal direction. So for example, you can see that this is a line, reference line. So at this line, our section may break from here. It may break from this point, or it may break along this section. But in some time, our failure line may or may not be exactly perpendicular to the length of member. So it means that in order to study that fact, first of all, we need to understand different terminologies. So first of all, we are having a terminology which is referred as a pitch. So what is a pitch? Pitch is the center to center distance between two nearest bolt or two continuous bolt in a same line. So pitch is a distance between the center to center of two consecutive bolt in a same line. Similarly, for this line, pitch will be from center of this hole to the center of this hole. So the definition is written in the previous slide. So the center to center distance of fastener along longitudinal axis. Along longitudinal axis means that along the length of the member is called as the pitch, and it is denoted by small p. So pitch may be different in two lines. For example, the pitch of holes in this line may be 50 millimeter, and pitch of holes in second line may be 75 millimeter. It may or may not be same. But what is the pitch? It is a center to center distance between two consecutive holds in a same line, which is along the length of the member. And then we are having gauge. So gauge is a center to center distance of the hole in transversal direction. Transversal direction means that in perpendicular to length. So gauge distance is always perpendicular. It is not inclined. It is, or you can say that this is a distance between center line of holes, center lines of holes in two lines. So this is a center line of hole in line one, and this is the center line of hole in line two. So the difference of the center line of two center point of holes in two lines is referred as g. So it is always measured in transversal direction, or it is the shortest distance. So again, definition we will again read here. Center to center distance between fastener. Fastener means that may be bolt or rivet. Along transversal direction, transversal means perpendicular to length, is called gauge. So it is referred as a small g value. And similarly, we are having a terminology which is referred as stagger. So stagger is center to center distance of two. It is a center to center distance of two nearest bolt in longitudinal direction. So for example, we are having this hole, and also we are having this hole or this bolt. So this bolt and the nearest bolt, this bolt hole is nearest to this one, not this one. So it means that center to center distance of this hole and this hole in longitudinal direction will be referred as a stagger. So what is the difference? Pitch is the center to center distance between two holes in the same line, but stagger is the center to center distance between two nearest bolt in two adjacent lines. So again, we will read the definition. Where is the slide? So stagger, longitudinal distance between two nearest rivet, or you can say that instead of rivet, I would rather use the word fastener. Faster mean that it could be rivet or bolt. Longitudinal distance between two nearest fastener lying into different lines or into adjacent layer of rivet is referred as stagger. So it means that pitch is the center to center distance between two holes in the same line, and stagger is the center to center distance between two nearest holes into adjacent layer or into adjacent lines. So sometime we may have stagger present in our connection, or sometime we may not have any stagger in our connection. For example, in our previous example, so in this case, pitch is a distance from center to center, from the center of this bolt to center of this bolt, and gauge is a distance from the center of this hole to the center of this hole in transversal direction. So we are not having stagger here, because stagger will be zero, because distance, center to center distance between this bolt and this bolt in longitudinal direction is zero. So this is the connection assembly without any staggering, and here we are having a connection assembly with stagger arrangement. So I would like to show you maybe some diagram. So here, this is a vertical member of a truss which is connected with the gusset plate. So in this case, the bolts are only provided in one line. So we are only having pitch, center to center distance between two holes is pitch. And we are not having any gauge. Why we are not having gauge? Because bolts, they are only provided in one line. If the bolts are provided in two lines, then we may have gauge distance, or we may have stagger. Okay, here the bottom card or the bottom member is connected with the gutter plate, and here we have provided the bolts or fasteners in two lines. So here, from the center of this hole to the center of this hole in longitudinal direction is pitch. Similarly, center distance from the center of this hole to center of this hole may be the pitch of second line, and distance from center of this hole to the center of this hole in perpendicular direction will be the gauge distance, and distance from the center of this hole to the center of this hole in longitudinal direction is stagger. So here we are having the staggering assembly. So sometimes stagger may or may not be present. For example, if I am using this assembly, maybe if I provide, you can say the 6 bolt instead of 5. So in this case, we may have pitch and we may also have gauge distance, but the stagger will be 0. What is the stagger? Distance, difference of the center point of the holes in two layers in longitudinal direction. So it means that the center of this hole and this hole, they are lying along the same axis. So the difference of their centroid in longitudinal direction will be 0. So we will not have any stagger. We will only have the gauge distance from this center to this center in transversal direction, and pitch distance from the center of this hole to the nearest bolt. So I will move it. So rather we will only have, I will remain like this, I will change it later. So actually, why we are discussing this thing? We are discussing this thing for the reason that sometimes I told you that the cross section always fail at a distance which is perpendicular to the length. So our failure line in most of the case will be the main state, which is perpendicular length. Our section may fail from here. Section will always fail or rupture at a section where the net area is minimum. Net area minimum is that where the reduction of cross-sectional area due to punching of hole is maximum. So at this section, only one hole is passing. It means that we need to subtract the area of one hole from this section to compute the net area. Similarly, at this section, also one hole is present, and here also one hole is present. But sometimes our failure surface may be this line. It may be passing from A, then it is moving from B to C, then C to D. Our failure path may not be perfectly straight. It may be straight from A to B, then from B to C, it will pass from B to C, then it will progress from C to D. In this case, what is happening? So area or the failure line is passing through the two holes. So if it is passing from the two holes, then we need to subtract area of two holes. But in the same way, you know that we have in the gross area, we have taken this width or transversal direction. But you know that the inclined line, area of inclined line from B to C, it is more than the transversal or the shortest distance from B to C, this one, gauge. So inclined distance from B to C is more than G value. It means that if I'm considering the failure line or the rupture area passing from A, B, C to D, then this inclined area is more than this vertical or this transversal line or transversal area. In that case, what we do, we need to add more area in order to compute actual net area, because failure line is not straight, it is rather inclined. So actually AISC has recommended or given us an empirical formula to add additional area due to the inclined failure surface. So this additional area is only the function of staggering. where we are not having any stagger boards, we don't need to add that extra area. But how we may add, I will explain in the next slide. So additional area due to the inclined failure plane, just like each hole in the path of failure plane, the reduced net area or additional area will be equal to this one. So area equal to S square over 4G multiplied by thickness is added to the net area for each inclined line or for each inclined surface. It means that whenever our failure surface is inclined, so we need to add the area, because inclined surface will have more area as compared to the straight line. So in that case, our formula for the net area will be modified as it. So A net will be equal to A gross minus, let me multiply here N, and mean that if we are having more bolt, and also here we submission mean that number of inclined lines. So just we need to add one factor. So that factor may be for revert or maybe for fastness for each inclined line. It means that net area will be increased by this parameter if our failure surface will be inclined. So this addition of the area will only be applicable in case of staggering arrangement. If no stagger is available, because if stagger is zero, so this component will be zero. So our formula will be remain same. So actually, you know that area is equal to the net area width multiplied by thickness. Similarly, gross area, you can write it as a gross width, total width multiplied by thickness. And here we are also having thickness. So if you are dividing the entire equation by thickness, so it means that instead of computing the area, we can also compute the net width of the section which is causing the failure, because thickness is constant. So you can use the concept of area, or you may either use the concept of width. So net width is equal to gross width minus N D plus 3. So T is not being multiplied, plus sigma S square over 4G for revert. The net area must be calculated for all possible critical failure plane, and the least value must be taken or must be considered in order to compute the rupture capacity. A typical truss connection is shown in figure 2.7 with the gutter plate, just like I have explained it already. So this is the connection without, you can say that, a staggering arrangement. And if the stagger is there, then this connection will be like this, just like I have explained. Because a member will always break from the plane where our net area is minimum. Because when the net area is minimum, then rupture stress will approach to their ultimate limit first. Okay, now we are having an example. For example, here we are having a steel plate. This plate is continuous in this direction, but we have discontinued over here. So this is a sign of continuity. Total width of this plate is 305, and the thickness is given as a 6 millimeter. And further data, we have to see that determine minimum net area of plate shown in figure 2.8, where the location of 20 mm diameter fastener. This fastener we can assume as a rivet. 20 mm fastener, it is given, so it is also indicated. Okay, here, we may consider different type of failure zone. Just understand that T force is acting here and here. So this is the length of the member. Along the force direction, we are having length. Member will always break in transversal direction. So we need to consider different failure zones. Let's suppose, just to make you understand, we are having different options. Here I may consider this as a failure may occur from here. If I consider this failure line, so only one hole is passing through this failure line. It means that if I want to compute net area, I need to subtract the area of one hole only. Similarly, if I'm considering failure line this one, so failure line is passing through again from one hole. It means that if I want to compute net area, I need to deduct the area of only one hole. So net area will not be small. But on the other hand, if I am considering failure line here, this one in within, so from this failure line, so failure line or the rupture area, it is passing through two holes. It means that if I want to compute the net area, I need to subtract the area of two holes. It means that failure line which is passing through B and C, it will not be critical because A net will not be smaller. So let's suppose, first of all, I will consider this option. This option that our failure is occurring from bolt A to D directly. It is a straight line. So this line is a straight line, so we are not having stagger for this line. It is perfectly transversal or perfectly vertical with reference to longitudinal axis. So first of all, I will consider the net area from this failure line. So if I consider path AD, so our net area is equal to gross area minus N D plus 3 into thickness of the plate. So gross area, it can be computed because plate is having the width 305 and thickness 6 millimeter. So here, so you can say that we have computed the gross area minus N D plus 3. So we are given river size 20 millimeter. So 20 millimeter will be over here plus 3 extra margin to accommodate the river multiply by thickness, and N value will be 2. Why N will be 2? Because failure path is passing from two hole, so it means that we need to detect the area of two hole only, and it's this line, failure line, is perfectly you can say that it is straight, so we are not having any stagger, so our net area will be equal to 1554 millimeters. So here we are having one answer. Okay, now second option is that, please gentlemen, close your mic. Okay, here, now I will consider the failure path another one. So just I'm using different colors so that you will understand properly. So here, let me use color blue for whichever is visible. Maybe this blue color might be visible. Yes. So now the failure line is from A. Okay, now I'm considering failure surface passing from, it is moving from edge to A to B, then B to D, and then it becomes straight. So this is my failure surface. Failure surface is A, B, and D. Again, if I'm considering the failure path passing from A, B to D, so it means that in that case, my failure path is passing from three holes. A, B, and D. So in this case, what will happen? Number of the hole will be 3 in the formula. Okay, further, because we are having two inclined surfaces which are passing from the failure path. So our failure path is inclined, so we are having two inclined paths. So distance from A to B, which is in transversal direction, which is g value 65, it is less, but this inclined distance between A and B is more. It means that here we need to add extra area because we are having the inclined surface. So how many inclined surfaces we are having? Two. One from A to B and then B to D. So for each inclined surface, we have to add additional area in order to compute net area. Okay, let's see the equation over here. Okay, now our equation is the same. AN is equal to gross area minus number of the board into D plus 3 into T, which is the area of hole for the rivet that we have punched, plus addition of area due to each inclined surface. Okay, here gross area will be plate will remain same. Okay, now N value I have used 3. Why I have used 3? Because failure path is passing through 3 holes and N plus 3 into T will be remain same. Okay, now we are having two inclined surfaces, so we have to add two staggered area or two additional area for each staggered bolt or for each inclined surface. Okay, here, first if I consider from A to B, okay, stagger is a distance from center of hole A to the center of hole B in longitudinal direction, because hole A and B, they are in two different lines or two adjacent lines. They are not in the same line, so that is not pitch. So pitch is a distance from center of D to C, which is 54 plus 48. So distance from the center of hole A to the center of hole B in transversal direction is staggered, which is 54. And gauge is a distance from center of hole A to the center of hole B in transversal direction, which is 65. So S is 54, S square over 4G, which is 65, which will be this parameter. S square 54 over 4G. So this is the addition of area for this inclined surface from A to B. Okay, now we have to add the additional area for inclined surface B to D. So from B to D, distance from the center of the hole D to the center of hole B in longitudinal direction is again 54, which is referred as stagger. And distance from the center of hole B to the center of hole D in transversal direction is gauge, which is 100. So here, S is same scale over 4G, and this whole factor multiplied by 6, because this is additional line length of the inclined surface, and the whole parameter is multiplied with the 6 in order to convert the additional surface into the additional area. So if I compute net area, so net area is coming 1527. So this 1527, you can see that it is lesser than 1550. Why? Because even though we have added the area for the each inclined surface, but we are the failure is passing through 3 holes, so we are deducting the area of 3 holes. But since again we need to check another failure path, which is A, B, C. So failure line is this, you can say brown color. So failure surface is passing from this surface hole A, B to C, and then this. So failure may be this one. This means that our failure rupture may not always be exactly in the transversal direction, just like I have the big stick with this green line. So in this case, our formula will be the main same. So you can say that net area is equal to gross area minus 3, again 3, because our path is passing through the 3 hole. Okay, now this first parameter S 54 square over 4G will be remain same. Why this will be remain same? Because in path ABD and ABC, this inclined surface AB is same. But for inclined surface from B to C, stagger is 48, it is not 54. So it is 48, but G value will be remain same, 100. So if I'm substituting the values over here, so if I compute the net area, that is 1518 millimeters. So out of these three failure surfaces, the minimum net area is the area when I consider the failure path A, B, and C. It means that if this section or this plate is subjected to tensile force, so the failure will always occur from A, B to C. Failure will not occur from A, B to D or from A to D. Why? Because failure will always occur at a section or at a cross section where the net area is minimum, because the intensity of the stress will be more and the stress at that path will approach to ultimate learning force. So this is the concept behind staggering. You need to consider this staggering competition or addition of the area due to stagger when we are having stagger arrangement. If there is no any stagger arrangement, just the formula will be remain simple. AG minus N into D plus 3 multiplied by thickness. Okay, net area of structural shape. In the previous example, I explained the computation of net area for a simple steel plate. But how to compute the net area for structural steel shape? Structural steel shape means that if we are having angle section, I section, or channel section. For example, just like in the previous example here, the computation of net area for this angle section, which is used as the bottom card of this truss, will be different. How it will be different, I will explain. So in that case, what we will do? So this application will only be, this concept will only be considered if we are having staggering arrangement. If we are not having staggering arrangement, then the formula is same. A net is equal to A gross minus number of the bolt into D plus 3 multiplied by thickness. Okay, here I will explain that if we are having angle. In this angle section, what we will do? We are converting our angle section into equivalent steel plate. In order to compute area for structure where the staggered bolts are provided, or staggered arrangement of connection or the fastener is used. In that case, we need to convert the I section, angle section or channel section into equivalent steel plate. Equivalent steel plate means that we can straighten up this angle. For example, you can say that there is a pivot. Pivot means that we have punched the hole and this vertical leg and the bottom leg, they are separate plate. And here we have punched the hole and we have used maybe one pivot or rivet. So when we are straightening it, so this angle is also having some thickness, and this angle, it is also having some thickness. So half of the thickness is rotated, it go to the upside, and half of the thickness of the vertical leg, it will also maybe coincide or superimpose on this half thickness of this bottom leg. So GA is the distance, it is a gauge distance from center of hole on leg one to the bottom face, and GB is the gauge distance from center of the hole in other leg to the edge of this angle section. So in that case, this GA, and if we are adding GA and GB, so we need to subtract the half thickness of the angle from the one side, half from the other side. So the total center to center distance between these two bolts when we are straightening up will be equal to GA, GB minus D. So it means that when we are converting this angle into a steel plate, then the distance between the center of the center of hole to the vertical leg or the one leg to the center of distance on horizontal leg, it is reduced by thickness of angle section. So GA and GB value. Similarly, when we are straightening up this plate on the upper side, so we are having total depth. Total depth of the section we can get from this section properties table. So GA, it is a gauge distance from center of the web to center of the hole. So where we will get G and GB value, I will explain in the upcoming slide. So in that case, when we are straightening up this flank to make to convert into equivalent plate, then half of the flank thickness or web thickness is merged within the flank thickness. So it the total distance from the bottom surface of the flank to the center of the hole will become equal to G minus half thickness of that. So here I will explain these distances from the next slide. So these distances GA and GB, these are standard distance. So where we have to punch the hole, for example, if this leg is dimension is 100, so if we want to punch the hole, we cannot punch the hole at any point. For example, I can't punch the hole over here or here. So that I need to punch the hole at certain specific distance, and this distance is governed by or it is specified by AISC. So let me tell you the table where these distances are available on LRFD manual, because you need to consult this table in your examination or for your solution of assignment problem. So let me check the LRFD manual. Still unable to find. So these tables are also available in book. I am able to find because I need to tell you the exact place where these tables are available, because you have to consult them frequently. Anybody who is having LRFD design aid with him, please also start finding. And just let me know the page number.
Page number 100, I think so.
100, yes, page number 100. Because last time it was maybe on page number, maybe 105. So it is on page number 100, yes. It is, this table is given on page number 100. Okay, you need to understand this table and this G value. Okay, if the leg dimension is less than 102, then we can only provide one hole. For example, what I must say, so what I want to convey here, that if leg of the dimension is less than 102, we cannot punch two hole on one leg. So let's suppose I am having an angle section. Just to explain to you, here, I suppose if I am having an angle section which is given over here, so this is 152, 102, and 12.7. 152 is the length of larger leg, and 102 is length of smaller leg. So if I am having this larger leg, so in larger leg, I can, this is the length dimension 152. I can provide two bolts. If I want to provide two bolts on larger leg, then I will have G1 and G2. In that case, G1 value will be 57. So 57 is a fixed distance. Then I need to punch the hole from this edge to the center point. The distance from the center of the hole to this edge must be 57. This cannot be more than 57 or less than 57. And then for the second hole, if I want to punch a second hole on the same leg, because I want to provide two holes or two fast the faster in two line, then G2 value must be equal to 64. So this would be arranged. It means that for this angle section, if I'm having the larger leg 152, G1 value will be 57 and G2 value will be 64. So in the examination, you will not be provided with this G2 value and G1 value. You will be just given that the bolts are provided either in one line or two line for the angle section is this one. If you know the designation, you can consult the table which is given on page number 100, so you can compute this system. Okay, this leg dimension, this is 102. So if the leg dimension is 102, it means that in that case, we will have only G value, and for 102, G value is equal to 64. So G distance will be 64. Okay, another way, if I'm having the same section, same, but here I opted only one bolt on this vertical leg also, then in that case, if I am providing only one bolt, I will only have G value, not G1, G2. In that case, it is 152, so for 152, G value will be 89. It means that for a leg dimension 152, if I want to provide only one hole or one fastener in that leg, then distance from the center of the hole to the edge must be equal to 89. If I want to punch two holes, then I will have G1 and G2, and the distance G1 will be equal to 57 and G2 will be 54. And for example, in this case, let me change the dimension, and let's suppose I'm considering this as a 76, and 76, and this dimension I want to consider as 64. This means that larger leg will be 76 and 64. So if the leg dimension is 102, I cannot provide number of the bolt more than in two lines. So if this dimension is 76, so G value will be 44. So G value for this larger leg will be 44, and this shorter leg is 64. So G value for this shorter leg will be 35. So it means that we have to pick this G1, G2, and G value from this table, which are given on page number 100. On your LRFD manual. Similarly, we may have G1 and G2 value for our channel section. So G1, if we are connecting flange by punching the hole in web, then we are having G1 value. If we are connecting a channel section by punching the hole in flange, then it is a G value. So a range is given over here. So what is the range? If for G value, it is related with BF value or width of the flange. If width of the flange is ranging 52 to 64, then G value must be 33. And if BF value, width of the flange is ranging between 82 and 90, then G value will be 51. And if BF value is less than 46, so G value will be remain 25. And similarly, for our G1 value, it is related with the depth of channel section. If the depth is ranging between 150 to 239, so G1 value will be 57. So we can pick G1 and G2 value for any steel structure shape from this table. Okay, now I would like to discuss example problem here. We are having determine the net area for angle section given in figure 2.10. If 18 mm diameter fastener is used. So here we are given the fastener, so we can assume this is as a rivet. If nothing is mentioned, you can assume as a rivet. If it is mentioned as a bolt, then the formula is different, so you have to consult the table to compute the diameter of the hole. Okay, here the computation of net area is not simple. Why not simple? Because this is our horizontal leg, this is our vertical leg. So if I am working toward this side, so this will be its front or longitudinal view. So the hole which is punched on horizontal leg, so this hole is in the line of the hole on the top hole which is on the vertical leg. But on our vertical leg, holes are punched in two lines, but they are staggered. Staggered means that if this hole might be over here and this hole might be over here, this means that if I'm considering any failure line, if I'm considering the failure line, so let's suppose this is a failure line. So our failure line is exactly passing through the center of three holes. In that case, the computation of the net area is very simple. We know the gross area. Gross area of this angle section, it can directly be taken from LRFD manual, from sectional properties table. And our failure line is passing through three holes. Just detect the area of three holes only. But it is not like that. Why? Because our holes, they are provided staggered. In that case, staggering case, we are not having a steel plate. So what we supposed to do? First of all, we need to convert this angle section into steel plate, equivalent steel plate. So how we can convert? Because we are we need to straighten this horizontal leg also. So in this case, we must be knowing this G value, G1 and G2 value. Okay, in examination, you will not be provided with G2 value, G1 and G4. You may only be provided with designation of angle section, and you will be provided with this pitch. So let's confirm from the table. So our larger leg is 152. So if larger leg is 152, so G1 value should be 57 and 64, G2. Let's check whether they are same or not. So for 152, G1 is 57 and G2 is 64. And then our shorter leg is 102. So in that case, our G value should be 64. So yes, they are same, which are given. Okay, now I am telling that we are straightening up. When I will straighten, so when I'm straightening, so I the distance from the center of this hole to the center of this hole will become equal to 57 plus 64 minus thickness of this section, because half thickness of this section will merge with the half thickness of the vertical leg. So see here, distance from the center of the hole to the center of hole B in vertical direction is 64, that will be the main thing. But distance from the center of hole B to the center of hole C in transversal direction will become 57 plus 64 minus thickness, just like I have explained. So this will be the our plate, equivalent plate. So actually we know the area of this plate, because area of this plate will be equal to the area of this angle section. And for this angle section, designation is, again, what is the designation? That is 152 into 102 into 12.7. If you are having LRFD manual with you, So let me find the area. Yes, open page number 56. Open page number 56. If you are opening the page number 56 on LRFD manual, you will see that there are three groups provided for angle section. And in the third group, the fourth section from bottom, that is angle section 152 into 102 into 12.7. And area of that angle section is 3060. Area is 3060. So gross area of that section is 3060. That you can consult. So now what you need to do, you know the gross area already. So let me write the gross area somewhere here. So from table, I have picked the gross area. So gross area for this is 3060 millimeter square. So gross area is given. Okay, now it is rest of the problem become very simple. You know the gross area. You need to consider different failure zones. For example, if you don't suppose to consider this failure line, because only one hole is passing through the failure line, at this point, two holes are passing through the failure line, and at this point also two holes are passing. So you may consider either path AC and this path. Both are same, so the net will be same. So consider only one path from A to C. So you can compute net area. Second is that you may consider failure path passing from A, B to C. In third case, you can consider failure area passing through A, B and D. In that case, you are having three options. And you can compute net area. So the problem is solved in book. So for the detailed solution, you can consult book. So if you will have any problem, you can ask me the question in the upcoming slide. So I have already explained the procedure. So only the thing is that you need to convert the distance, the central distance between the hole B, which is on the vertical leg, to the center of the hole C, which is on our horizontal leg. So that will be equal to summation of their gauge value minus thickness of section. So gross area is taken from table. So if you consult a book, I believe you will be able to compute net area successfully. So I will stop here. So at this point, I would like to take questions. So if anybody is having, okay, I will take. So. Yes, please ask.
Sir, अगर हमारे पास दो जगह पे exactly same area आ रहा है तो हमें कैसे पता चलेगा कि इन दोनों में से किस जगह से पिक हो?
नहीं देखो ना इसमें I understand your question. That is common sense. If for example I have given you example, this example. So path AC and this path only consider one because both will have same net area. You understand me? So you can write that AC or maybe you can say that this hole is ED. So both are same. So that is your judgment. But I will let you know that after AC, I will only determine the path A, B and D or A, B, C. Why? Because I am having this formula. That is the common sense that will develop or in sense when you are solving the problem. For example, in this formula, where is the formula? Yes, here. If all these two parameters, they are constant, this one, then it means that net area will be minimum if this parameter is minimum, and this parameter will be minimum if the stagger is minimum or g value is more. So you have to try it. If you do not know, then you need to try all the possible paths. But if you are solving the equation smartly, you can directly pick up the first path, which will be the minimum, if you are having the understanding of S square over 4G formula, because more will be the staggered distance, more will be the addition of this area, and more will be A net. So when S will be minimum and G will be more, in only in that case you will have least net area.
सर अगर हमारे पास कोई सेक्शन है जिसमें दो जगह पे सेम ही एरिया है, मतलब एक जगह पे एक होल है, दूसरी जगह पे भी एक होल है, मतलब उन दोनों में से किसी जगह उसने ब्रेक करना और दोनों का एरिया सेम है, तो उन दोनों में हम कौन सा कंसीडर करेंगे?
कोई भी यही तो मैं आपको बता रहा हूँ, समझ नहीं आ रही कि आपने ये जो बताई है, कोई भी एक कंसीडर कर लें।
सर प्रैक्टिकली वो ब्रेक किधर से करेगा फिर?
I'm telling you that I got your question, लेकिन मैं दोबारा फिर explain कर देता हूँ। For example, I'm explaining these two brown lines, both they will have same net area. I'm considering that failure may either occur from A to C or from this E to D. In that case, there is a possibility that failure will occur simultaneously from A to C and from this hole to this hole. Or sometime if we are having some design flaws which are not in my control, by mistake, if this hole is overpunched, maybe the hole size is 1 millimeter more, then the failure will occur from that line. But only in simple word, if you know that both all the four holes, they are perfectly having same size, then the failure will occur simultaneously from A to C or from this E to D, or it may
occur okay,
you understand?
Okay, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
अगर इसमें कोई माइक्रोस्कोपिक ऐसा फ्लॉ कहीं पर रह गया जिसको हम नहीं काउंटर कर सके, तो जो वीकेस्ट प्लेन होगी इन दोनों में से वहां पे होगा, यानी कि पंचिंग के दौरान एक होल का साइज वन होल साइज में भी बिकम लार्जर, तो एट दैट पॉइंट एक्चुअल नेट एरिया विल बी लेस देन माय एंटीसिपेशन, सो फेलियर में अकर. Otherwise, if both are perfectly identical, then failure will occur simultaneously from this same point. Any question? Anyone else is having questions? Okay. Gentlemen, maybe I will not provide these slides with you because I am consulting this book. So I urge that when I'm coming online for the lecture, you must either have book with you and LRFD manual, it is essential, and try to write down your notes on the same book, because I am referring or consulting the book by Dr. Zahir Ahmed Siddiqui as a textbook. So the first three slides I have provided to you. So my previous recording, they have already uploaded, so I will share the link with you today. So inshallah, I will see you at 1 p.m. for the lab design lecture. So, love is.